So welcome to this press conference after the first day of the informal meeting of economic and finance ministers. We will start with Estonian Minister for Finance, Toomas Tõniste, who will give an outline of the outcome of the meeting, and then I will give the floor to the governor of the National Bank of Estonia, Ardo Hansson, to talk also a bit about the fintech discussion. Then I will give the floor to the Vice President of the European Commission, Mr. Dombrovskis, and in the end, the floor will be given to Vice President of the European Central Bank, Constâncio. After that, we will have time for your questions. So with no more introductions, please, Minister.
Tere, head ajakirjanikud. Mul on väga meel, et tänane ECOFINi arutelu oli huvitav ja ka väga sisuline. Ja ma tänan tõesti väga kõiki kolleege selle eest. Nüüd sisust. Esmalt keskendusime kohtumisel sellele, kuidas muuta majandus- ja rahaliitu tugevamaks. Majandus- ja rahaliidu tulevik on üks Euroopa Liidu suuri küsimusi, mis läheb korda kõigile 28 liikmesriigile. Me kõik oleme huvitatud sellest, et nii euro kui kogu ühine rahapoliitika oleks tugev, et eelarvepoliitika oleks selgelt juhitud, et kõik meie majanduskriisi ajal tehtud pingutused kannaksid vilja. Tänane diskussioon keskendus sellele, mida on võimalik juba olemasolevate protseduuridega, reeglite ning Euroopa Liidu eelarve võimaluste valguses majandus- ja rahaliidu tugevdamiseks teha. Rääkisime reeglite tõhustamisest, riskide juhtimistruktuuri parandamisest. Ministrid vahetasid mõtteid, kuidas saaks Euroopa Liidu eelarvega senises selgemalt toetada struktuuri reforme ja tugevdada Euroopa raha- ja majandusliidu majanduspoliitikate koordineerimisega. Mitme euroala ministri suust jäi kõlama mõte, et praegune soodne majanduskeskkond on hea hetk muutusteks ning palusime Euroopa Komissionil mõelda praktiliste sammude peale, mida saaks ja peaks nüüd tegema. Teise teemana keskendusime tehnoloogilistele uuendustele finantsteenuste sektoris. Käsitlesime seda teemat kapitaliturgude liidu arendamise kontekstis. Keskendusime sellele, kas ja kuidas tuleks finantsinnovatsiooni reguleerida ja raamistada, et me ei jätaks innovatsiooni potentsiaali kasutamata ja samas ka ei reguleeriks sektorit üle. Täpsemalt räägib sellest Eesti Panga president Ardo Hansson. Ma olen kindel, et täna päeval arutatu aitab viia meid mõne konkreetse otsuseni, mis muudab majandus- ja rahaliitu tugevamaks ning kindlustab Euroopa Liidu konkurentsivõime finantsinnovatsiooni areneval turul. Aitäh teile!
Thank you, Minister. Governor Hansson.
Thank you, Minister, and thank you, everybody. So the second part of today's discussion focused on fintech or technology-enabled innovation in financial services. I think there was broad appreciation that this was a timely discussion given the emergence of these markets. So why did we talk about fintech? I think the financial sector plays a key role in the economy, and technological innovation in that sector has great potential. So far, it's still relatively small, but you can't exclude that it will grow a lot and it can provide new and affordably priced financial services and improve access to financing, for example, for small and medium-sized enterprises and others. Fintech could also offer alternatives to the traditional banking business model by attracting depositors to non-banks or facilitating new trends such as peer-to-peer lending or crowdfunding. And financial institutions all around the world are thinking about how to make use of these opportunities to capture the potential, perhaps to improve efficiency, strengthen their competitive position. On the other hand, it has both risks and benefits. Currently, the fintech is a risk mostly for its users, but given its small scale, it's at present doesn't present compelling financial stability risks. But we need to understand the nature of the evolution to foster innovations, to look at emerging risks, and to balance whether on see whether on balance the net benefits are positive or not, and that presumably needs to be done on a case-by-case basis. The EU has acknowledged the importance of this theme, and European Commission has emphasized the role of fintech in its Capital Markets Union initiative, and as we discussed today, fintech will also have an effect on the banking union. Early this year, the Commission conducted a public consultation on fintech, and its initial results point to the need of lowering the barriers to entry to the single market and improving access to financial services, and eventually the Commission is expected to present an EU strategy for fintech. And all central banks in the EU are continuously monitoring fintech developments that affect financial market infrastructure, in particular in the field of payments. So some of the key conclusions, I think today, it wasn't more to conclude, but to help build a basis for understanding which regulatory and supervisory framework is appropriate for fintech in the EU. And first of all, we need, I think, a dialogue between legislators, supervisors, and market players. However, there seems to be an emerging common understanding that regulation needs to be technology neutral. We understand that there's support for an idea to involve more than one supervisory agency in the process. Currently, most of the fintechs are domestic, but they will probably grow across borders in the EU and globally because here the size of the market matters, and we have seen the benefits of the single market in the EU, and in the same vein, we could strive to create a more level playing field for fintech in all EU member states so that innovative solutions are accessible to all. On the other hand, the users of innovative solutions need to be protected, and financial stability needs to be safeguarded. We need to think of issues like anti-money laundering, competition policy, cybersecurity, and so on. There was an emerging consensus that the consumer needs to be put in the center of any future discussions on fintech. So the principle of level playing field implies that consumer protection and risk management measures should be rather similar across member states. Thank you.
Thank you, Governor. Vice President Dombrovskis, please.
Good evening. First of all, I would like to thank Estonian Presidency for the warm welcome in Tallinn and for organizing this timely discussion on economic and monetary union. We also discussed fintech in a broader context of digital innovation. On the economic and monetary union, we discussed the rules and institutions of our union. And it's clear that strong economic and monetary union needs both well-functioning institutions and credible rules. Both rules and institutions were strengthened during our response to the crisis, but there is a room for making EMU governance more efficient, complete, and transparent. However, reforms shouldn't be done for the sake of reforms. Form must follow the substance, so institutions should evolve to meet the objectives we set. Commission believes that future EMU development should happen within the EU or community legal framework. This applies to possible future transformation of the European Stability Mechanism into European Monetary Fund, which then should be firmly anchored in a community framework. And it also concerns possible creation of a European Minister for Economy and Finance. This minister should also work to promote structural reform efforts in building on the work which we do already since 2015 with a structural reform support service. The Minister of Economy and Finance is one of the initiatives which we intend to launch with a 2025 perspective. We discussed the link between the EMU and EU budget and in particular link with structural reforms and euro area fiscal stabilization function. So this is part of our idea to have euro area budget line within EU budget. All these topics which I mentioned will feature in the Commission's EMU package, which we intend to put forward on 6th of December. And today's discussions provides us with a valuable input for our preparatory work. Then on the second topic, so we also discussed one of the key capital markets union files, fintech, and well, the fintech revolution which we are facing. We already see fintech services such as mobile payments, peer-to-peer lending, online investments benefiting millions of Europeans. Looking ahead in the future, technologies like artificial intelligence, distributed ledgers, and cloud computing hold even greater potential. Ministers agreed that Europe should support the development of fintech sector, emphasizing the importance of technology neutrality. And this will only work if our companies will be able to take advantage of our single market, meaning to scale up so that they can compete with their rivals in China and the US, where fintech is booming. For example, we are looking into EU-wide enabling legislation for crowdfunding and peer-to-peer lending. This would increase the scale and facilitate cross-border activity in this rapidly growing sector. As to regulation, many spoke in favor of adopting existing rules to the challenges what fintechs brings, such as cyber threats and data privacy. But it's also important that fintech is not regulated to this before even this sector has evolved. So the Commission is currently working on the fintech action plan, which we intend to present early next year. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Vice President. And now the floor to Vice President Constâncio.
Yes, I will address the very important topic of the deepening and strengthening of the EMU, seen, of course, from the angle of the central bank that is responsible for the single monetary policy and for the euro. And the way we see it, there is the need to deepen integration in other areas so that the monetary EMU is not so much dependent as now from monetary policy alone. But in this deepening, we should start by implementing those points that are already discussed and agreed upon. And the first one is, of course, the completion of banking union. And completion of banking union means three things, basically. In the first place, there are still too many national options and discretion of decisions by national authorities in what regards supervision of banks. And so we would like to see that there would be a reduction of these national options. Second, and more importantly, the completion of banking union implies also that the European Deposit Guarantee Scheme would be decided upon along the lines of the proposal that the Commission has made. And the third point is also something that has been discussed, the backstop to the European Resolution Fund, all that to give more confidence to all the mechanisms of a banking union. The second important project that has already been launched and discussed is the Capital Markets Union. That's very important for the smooth functioning of a monetary union, as for instance, taking the example of the United States, because a capital markets union creates private mechanisms of risk sharing within the space of the monetary union, and that's very important to accommodate recessions, vulnerabilities that may happen in certain parts of the union. So this is a very ambitious project, the project of a capital markets union that implies a lot of harmonization of some fundamental legislation, but seen from our perspective, that's an important step to really strengthen and the functioning of the monetary union. turning to new needs as we see them from our angle. The first one is, of course, to strengthen the resilience of monetary union, which has been, by the way, strengthened recently by the adjustment that the countries that suffered more during the crisis did themselves, because now they are all growing with positive economic growth, but at the same time they were able to reduce their external deficits and reduce their budget deficits to a point where they are complying with the Stability and Growth Pact and have a balance or slightly positive current account with the rest of the world. So this resilience has been improved, but more is necessary. And for that, we need, from our perspective, that the established macroeconomic imbalances procedure would be fully used in order for countries to take in a symmetric way all the reforms that still are necessary in order to have a more balanced monetary union. And finally, the final point for the new need is indeed what the report of the five presidents, which was of course co-signed by our own president, means by the creation of a stabilization, a fiscal stabilization function in the monetary union, so that in particular phases of recessionary periods, we would not have to rely only on monetary policy, as it was the case in the past few years, but that there would be this other function. It's a very important decision for the member states to take, if they so wish, but that would improve, indeed, the functioning of monetary union. And only if this function, this new stabilization function, would be created, we see then some possible consequences for some other ideas that have been floating around, like the concept of a minister of finance and other reforms that indeed appear linked to this creation of a stabilization function in the monetary union. Thank you.
Thank you, Vice President. We'll move on to your questions. Please state your name and the media you work for, and also please indicate to whom you address the question. Jim, in the back there.
Thanks. Jim Brunsden for the Financial Times here in the back. I've got two questions. One, I guess, more directed towards the Commission, and the other directed more towards the ECB. For the Commission, I apologize if this has been covered a bit. I was slightly late in. But Vice President, the Commission is going to come out with a new banking union package in a few weeks. Is it possible to outline as far as possible what that will do compared to what's on the table already? And for the ECB, Vice President, we've heard a lot about the need to seize this window of opportunity to complete euro area reform. Yep. What's the cost of not doing that? What's the worst case scenario where we don't succeed politically and we're left in the status quo? Thank you.
To respond to this first question on the banking union, indeed, when presenting the completion of economic and monetary union, we highlighted the importance also to put in place the missing elements of the banking union and also to complete the capital markets union. So what we'll be providing in next months is basically some elements, some considerations how we could accelerate the work on the existing proposals, on the existing risk reduction package which we put forward already in November last year, and on the European deposit insurance scheme. So it's more like an input how to move forward with already existing initiatives.
Yes, from our point of view and answering your question, it's not immediate. Immediately, we are in a situation where the recovery has strengthened and it's broad. Now all countries are growing and so on, as I said, and big adjustments have been achieved. But it's more looking forward to the smooth functioning and successful functioning of a monetary union. The more immediate thing, and the one that would be missed first, would be the completion of monetary union. That would be really necessary and has been sufficiently discussed in our view. The capital markets union, full-fledged capital markets union, is a very ambitious and so medium to long-term project, and we acknowledge that, that it's not immediate, although the first steps were already implemented by the Commission, and we are progressing. But it's certainly difficult to reach the final stage, and we acknowledge that. And then is indeed looking forward is the creation of that fiscal stabilization function, which would be important when, in the future, some new recessionary period would come. And as we know from history and experience of our economies, these periods come from time to time. Not, I think and hope and expect, not as strong as the one that we had with the crisis, but milder recession periods would also be very much helped by the existence of this fiscal stabilization function.
I don't see, yes, down there, please, Mark.
Yeah. Sorry, good evening, Mark Papercorn, Voskan, Netherlands. It's a question for Mr. Dombrovskis. You just heard your, the ECB and Mr. Constâncio say that actually the last part of the, let's say, the changing the European Monetary Union would be to talk about a European Minister of Economy and Finance. Did he convince you? I ask it because Mr. Juncker actually said Wednesday something different. Thanks.
Oh, it's also for me then. Yeah, yeah, okay. Very good. No.
On the European Minister of Economy and Finance, something which I outlined already in the introductory remarks, indeed, this is an initiative which we are launching with 2025 perspective. And indeed, there are a number of elements which we need to put in place, including euro area fiscal stabilization function. It's one of the elements which we also discussed during today's ECOFIN, possible modalities for the stabilization function, including European investment protection scheme. We discussed how to support structural reforms in both euro area member states and member states which are willing to join euro area, how to support this preparation process for euro area. So there are a number of initiatives which have to be seen in together in the same context. Mm-hmm.
If I may very briefly just to react to the terms of the question. What I meant was that we are not part of those discussions, so we don't know what are the proposals behind. And what came to the public is still vague about the functions, the exact role of that potential financial minister. And what I meant was that as we see it, now with the knowledge that we have, we see that could be meaningful, as I said, if it is attached to the creation of a fiscal stabilization function.
Gentleman in the front here.
Francesco Horacio Reuters, sorry, if I can ask a question to Commissioner Dombrovskis on an issue that is not part of the agenda today, but since we have seen a comment from former ECB board member Gonzalez Paramo saying that the banking rules on resolution could pose risks of bank runs because they hit also uninsured depositors. They could. I don't know if you have a reaction to that. Thanks.
The Commission's general point on this that we do not comment on comments, especially when I have not heard those comments yet. In any case, the banking union rules are in place, and recently we had a real test on those banking union rules in case of Monte Paschi di Siena in case of Veneto Vicenza, in case of Banco Popular in Spain, which all were basically following different avenues which are possible within banking union, precautionary recapitalization, liquidation under national insolvency law, resolution, and we saw that all those three avenues practically work. We now, of course, do some follow-up from those first real experiences, but our conclusion is indeed that banking union rules work.
I see no further questions. So with that, I conclude this press conference. Thank you very much for coming, and hope to see you tomorrow again.